we all did it. No matter the color, we threw it up, we all lived it. Trying to get that money like a tall midget, all tickets. Young B, Tech 9, this is all sixes. All seven, call Kevin and we all click, click. Best believe I got that best destiny sickest. Rest of these switches, bet your chest will be quickest. Huh? Nigga, what? Nigga, huh? Nigga, huh? Nigga, what? From the G.
Yeah, sir. Real niggas definitely in the motherfucking building doing big things, man. And like I said, man, the big homie is in the motherfucking building. And we bring to you, with no further ado, the big homie, Young Bleed. What it do, homie?
Hey, what's good, Catfoil? What is it?
Oh, man, shit, it's a beautiful thing, man. G'd up listeners, Young Bleed on the line. Hey, man, I gotta say off top, man, thanks a million, fam, for coming through and fucking with us, man. It really mean a lot coming from you, man.
I appreciate that from y'all, bro. You know, all the way around, bro. Spend it down at the eighth time, you hear?
Already official tissue. So, man, for these dumb-dumbs and these don't-knows, we sure gonna make sure they know tonight. Let everybody know, man, who Young Bleed is, fam, and what you bring to the game.
Okay, but for the worldwide, man, I am the originator, Mr. How You Do That There himself, Mr. I Smoke, I Drink, rest in peace to my man, Magic Free, my little cutie, my little kinfolk, little boosie, man, that's what that is, you know?
Already, official tissue, man, and I mean, you know, it's 2013, man, and I mean, we definitely got to jump right into it, man. How You Do That There? Now, me personally, I know this was original cut from the concentration camp. I had all the original C-Loke shit, you feel me?
Yeah, man.
Including you. How did that song come about initially? How You Do That There?
It go way back with it. That started for the world. Anybody that snatched my record and run around with it, that really started in my mama back room, man. Our concept, you know, the whole idea of it, you know, the lyrical part. Drum and so on and so forth, and my guy Happy Perez, Nathan Happy Perez, man, was the main producer guy at the concentration camp at the time. So we sat down and put our ears together and constructed the song originally, you know, before it got to No Limit, of course. But like you said, it originated on the self-titled concentration camp first album, huh?
Yeah, sir. And y'all conducted that song originally yourself. So let me ask you this. I'm taking it this has something to do with the whole Coming to No Limit thing, because P heard that hit. But was it a hit when you first made it, or it didn't get as big as it was until it was on the About It soundtrack?
Well, on a national level, it wasn't as big before the whole Southern region, and in particular Baton Rouge. It was number one on the radio already before P remixed it with. But it was on this rise, you know, P was in his evolution and doing About It, moving all that sort of time, and everything kind of came together. And I had that opportunity, he liked it enough, where he offered to do the remix and all, of course, you know, started on About It soundtrack. The rest was history, you know?
Already, G'd up listeners, listen to this real shit, man. Young Bleed in the building. So let's get everybody hit, man, and take them on a little trip, man, of how everything got started, man. We know you was with, you know, the concentration camp, making big news, big noise, and Baton Rouge. How did everything come with you hooking up with Master P and No Limit?
Okay, with C-Lo behind his label at the time, C-Lo Records, you know, they being the label heads, P, of course, with No Limit. The waters in Baton Rouge, you know, like I know 45 minutes, you know what I mean? Kind of same way Dallas and H down in Texas. So, and I'm hit for that. You know, they was doing a few records already together. So, you know, P had one of everything we was doing pretty much at the camp. Of course, we was following No Limit. So, like I say, on the in-between, you know, I had a chance to put out my first solo joint on C-Lo Records. And like I say, Peacock, we and Dug It, you know, he dug it enough. And, you know, we put it together, but they had a connection between each other where they were doing a lot of independent work between Baton Rouge and New Orleans. You know?
Already. That's definitely official tissue, man, and that's basically how I hooked up. So what's good with the homie C-Lo real quick, like, man? You still keep in touch with him? Y'all still tight and doing any music?
Well, I hate to say, you know, people know from his point, man, when the evolution of all that taking place, you know, we kind of went through the NWA thing, man. So, man, Lo, you know, we're lifetime homeboys, 11, 12 years old, as kids. I was a rapper, he was a DJ real young. And we was always doing the music thing, but you know, growing up, we both from South Baton Rouge. A lot of people are more familiar with Boosie nowadays. So when you hear Boosie talking about South Baton Rouge, the bottom and the top and across the back, you know, we come from those same places. So we really built the umbrella that gave birth to a lot of things that came out of that in particular. You know what I mean? Boosie birth with the camp, with the youngest in the camp. We all been from the same neighborhood, me and Boosie the same family. It kind of click, clack, click. But, yeah, so much with that, man. At the time, it just was a constant, you know, more or less evolution, bro, what was taking place for us. Louisiana and that whole southern region. So we got aboard that train, you know, everything just started to evolve from that, you know.
Already, official tissue. Listen up, G-Dub listener. Free Boosie Boo. Now, I gotta ask you this, man, especially for the G-Dub listeners, man, to really get a grasp of it. You come to No Limit, everything popping. You know, me personally, I think the album, My Balls, My Work, came out of nowhere. I mean, it just dropped. At the time, we was buying No Limit music. So let me at least ask you that. How did that go about as far as it just coming out like it did? Like, was you down with that? Did you want more promo for it or whatever? Even though it still went one. You feel me?
Yeah.
You know, how did you feel about it just coming out the way it did?
Well, you know, of course, we all was working. You know, the camp was the camp. No Limit was No Limit. You know, shout out to the boot camp clique at the time. Big Boy Rapper, you know, where cats like Mr. Willie Ball from, you know, Black Tennis, you know, the Ghetto Twins, and so on and so forth. We all see each other working. So, after those camp records, we started making the camp records. He looked at a couple of solo records. I started getting notoriety for that, so it was the push for me to do a solo rep. So naturally, me, I had the career, start working on my solo joint. Shout out to Laylo, Mac Manila, and Jay Vaughn. Had it with me originally. They produced, and they was the group Laylo together. It was my younger homeboy that I introduced to C-Lo later and brought us all together under one umbrella. And we needed a quick name. You know, everybody was on boot camp. Like I said, boot camp, click song, so forth. Well, you know, I come up with the concentration camp to give us all umbrella, more or less, to be all within us. But, you know, basically, that we worked on that record, man. Had a whole lot of joints. I think I might have finished like 14 songs in the midst of the entries that P gave, and of course, priority records eventually. We redid 3 to 4 songs, you know, to give at least about a pound to what we was doing at the concentration camp to put P on my record, you know, Mystical, of course, shout out to Fiend, you know, so we, Pimp Steve, rest in peace, produced Bring the Noise on the record, but I originally set out to do it for Mystical of 504 Boy Records, and in the midst of doing those last few songs, that's one of the songs I picked from out of No Limit catalog, and I'm doing replacing of a couple of songs that I had on my original Boss, my word out. But once it hit the ground running, you know, P loved it enough to where he promoted it on the highest scale. Priority got wind of it. They promoted it. Of course, we was doing from an underground, more independent, local, regional standpoint for us. C-Lo Brothers, Baton Rouge, Louisiana, and surrounding area. You know, it just got big. It got a fire after that. That record actually come out in 1998. And charted number one Billboard charts for hip hop and R&B, man. It was the number one record in the world the first 3 weeks it came out after the evolution about it. So it gave a perfect alley hoop that I just followed up on, and the rest, you know, blowing the wind, more or less, you know.
Already. G-Dub, listen to this game, baby. That's official tissue, man. Like, you know, a lot of that I didn't even know about Pimp C. You know what I'm saying? you know, doing that beat for you. You got any untold stories, man, or Pimp C, something real quick? You feel me? One real one?
Yeah, I got a few, man. Actually, rest in peace to Mama West. Mama West was like, you know, a mama to me. I talked to Mama West for years on the phone, negotiating. Shout out to Mel, you know what I mean? And took that Trill Entertainment. So those guys, Mel initially put me on the phone with Pimp C. Where I grew up, there, a lot of old men used to tell me, hey, man, you remind me of this cat named Chad. He's a cat was 56 years old. I had to be 21 years old. And that whole time, you know, of course, we knew about UGK. And a lot of people didn't know Pimp's name was Chad, so a lot of people don't know Pimp originally was from part of Louisiana. So a lot of people and old men knew Louisiana way, I mean, knew Pimp way in Baton Rouge. So them to tell you remind me of was Chad, you know, Chad Butler, MC. So, you know, of course, I always wanted to meet Pimp to have, you know, whatever was taking place between Texas and Louisiana, Lake Charles, surrounding areas. And we'll be close enough around each other, but I couldn't get there. I have a show this whole night. They got a show, and we never really picked together until one night I was on tour and with Priority for about 2 weeks. We were doing the whole South, and I ended up in Atlanta. And MJG is a good friend of mine as well as A-Ball, you know, their whole family. But he was the headliner promoting that No More Glory record. So I backstage with Thoreau from South Surfer, Twister, you know what I mean, out of Chicago. Guys that I knew, you know, at least like 97, 98 way back then. And a guy comes to me and taps on the shoulder and says, Pimp, I want to holler at you. I'm like, what Pimp, man? We're in Atlanta. I'm not thinking Pimp's here at the time. It was around the time when he was moving to Atlanta, so on and so forth. He was backstage at that show. So we had talked on the phone a couple of times, and we finally met in the flesh. It was, you know, a few years, you know, stuff like that before he went in. So went in and did his deed. So from that, and Pimp always stayed friends with good brother Pimp called me on Sunday. Hey, Pimp, hey, brother, business ain't go right, the money ain't right, bleed. I ain't call you about that. I called to see how you was doing. So from that, you know, I knew Pimp, you know, was a true brother, a true friend of mine. And over the years, you know what I mean, we always wretched at doing each other. He was actually supposed to be on my own record. The song I did with Too Short called Time and Money. Me and Too Short was five. So Too Short was living in Atlanta at the time. So, of course, you know, those my legends and OGs I looked up to. So when I got the game, I wanted to do records with the Scarface, the Ice Cube, you know what I mean, so on and so forth. I mean, with Pimp, you know what I mean, and a whole lot of brothers I mentioned. But we got together along those terms, and eventually Pimp caught a case to where it kind of strayed. I didn't get to talk to him the penitentiary time, but as soon as he come home, the first show I want to say was in H-Town, I know you don't know the name of this club, the Bodega or something like that. We first come home to, and you know, we reunited from that day on and pretty much ran together up until his demise. A whole lot of strength of me and him keeping up with each other. And shouts out to Pimpy Ken. You know what I mean? Pimpy Ken, a caller to me walking, always have us around each other. So we had plans on doing a lot of records. I know him and C-Bo was working on the record when he come home that I was supposed to be a part of. And different things like that, but a lot of people don't know. I don't think Pimp was home a year, maybe 6 months to a year when he was released before his demise. So, yeah, we always was family affiliated, man, to say from his mom's on down. Shouts out to Lee Corey, you know what I'm talking about, and Lee Chad Jr., man. So, you know, in a real family way, you know, it is just, you know, a few weeks ago for those that don't know, Mama West passed. So, you know, that was my lady, like she was my own mom. So, yeah, I got several stories I can tell you about Pimp. I put out a big kid when he was a true nigga to me, man. Real tough.
Already, man. Definitely. Rest in peace, Mama West, man. I definitely had, you know, plenty of times, you know, pleasure of meeting her, man. And rest in peace to the big Pimp official. And we got Young Bleed in the building. So let's keep them right, man. Let's keep them on track, man. So you everything pop off. You feel me? It's as far as No Limit. One album and done. And you come back with My Own. Now, we done had Fiend on. We done had Mr. Servone on. We always ask, you feel me, was there any issues as far as you leaving? And everybody say it's all good because P was like, do your thing. What happened, Bleed? What happened for you to leave No Limit? Still was with Priority, but leave the No Limit imprint. And be on your own after one album with No Limit.
cops. Well, the thing was this, man. You know, it was a situation or whatever that might have been. It was way over my head. He had been at Priority for years. Of course, before we got in the door, and he was always kicking into Priority rapping, so by way of, you know, him putting the rapping on the body soundtrack. Priority again got wind of me, and eventually they offered me a record deal. So, like, Ice Cube leaving NWA and went straight to Priority Records. A lot of people didn't know that's exactly what I did. Well, I signed straight to Priority and never really signed directly to No Limit, but it was on the strength of my feet. And we was all family affiliated, so we put a record together that seemed to be no different, you know what I mean, than any other No Limit record that was a No Limit dominated produce-based record, you know what I mean? We have Happy, he was a different producer than, you know, my man, shout out to Moby Dick, KLC, Craig B, and all the guys that was on Beats by the Pound. So that was the difference. He turned me on to Priority, so whatever may have taken place between those times, you know what I mean, in one sense, you know what I mean, it kind of strayed everybody through what everybody was going through individually, so on and so forth. So I was in like a 5, maybe 7 year, I know at a minimum of 5, a 5-hour deal with Priority Records, where it was time for me to go. I had to put a record out. And the only guys that were major existence other than the affiliates of the concentration camp and probably the only family who I've seen from out of Mississippi, Lee Time, Lucky Knuckles, rest in peace, the Growl Niggas, so on and so forth. Guys that came through on that record, only like on a national scale, a worldwide scale, you know, if you want to say it like that. His dad's Dillinger from the Dog Pound, you know, of course, he come down and recorded with me. And I had the privilege of recording with Too Short in Atlanta. So those two major guys that I had on that run with no limit affiliates. So we never had no beef and no bad blood. I just talked to P recently. We talked about doing some new records, of course, with the evolution of Problem and so on and so forth. So all of us talking. I ain't never really had no deals with nobody over there. Never with that type of situation. So rest was I had a record deal like going in the other day, y'all, you know what I mean? I had to get up for the work and produce every time I produced the record. So that's what was around about when that record evolved. So it was basically that. It wasn't no bad blood.
Already. Official tension, G-Dub listeners. Young Bleed in the building. And you know niggas want to know. That probably the main thing nigga want to know. You feel me? Like, what happened? Why the homie leave like that? So
yeah.
So I see you just mentioned the homie Problem. You understand me? Official Tissue. Now, we all know he got the Light Wide, which is basically a remix of and you you know how you do that there. Everybody and their mama on it. No Young Bleed. What's the deal with that, fam?
Well, I'll tell you two stories, man, and I'll say this, you know what I mean, regardless who's looking and listening. You know, we started off cool. The last record I put out Streetwise for the Young Bleed solo record. I had the privilege to work with Tech N9ne and the guys that's playing music. In 2011, I put out a record called Preserve, a book we called The Making of Preserve that was put together by my man, Sean Baker from Out the Source magazine. For those that are not familiar with Sean, he's the guy that started the series, the book series of called I'm the White Guy that's a hip-hop connoisseur, you know what I mean? Sit down in seminars and write books and different documentaries and so on and so forth. His first book was on the White Guy with Jay-Z. The second one, I want to say, was Tech N9ne, like Volume 2. Then eventually Glasses Malone and The Gang. I was the fifth rapper that he did a book on. So in the midst of that, I had the chance of working with this cat by the name of J-Rock. That's from out of Watts, California. That was, I think, Kendrick Lamar was J-Rock's hype man at one time, but Kendrick excelled.
TDE.
At that time, yeah, TDE, exactly. So this other guy, King Magnum P.I., you know, stay hands-on with me and Rock talk every now and again, but he's been so busy with Kendrick lately, I hadn't talked to Rock in a while. But I missed that, you know, man called me one day and was like, I got a young cat that I'm going to talk to you on the line, and that cat was Problem. So we talked. Let me know how he looked up, came up, listened to the music. He had to do the remix of the song and he wanted to check, you know, want me to check out and give my consent to be able to use the record. So I heard the record. I liked the record. So many cats on the ground and independent and mixtape level had always, you know, did something. Mentioned Young Berg at one time. I don't know Berg. I had never talked to Berg. You know, he had to do that there. Jay-Z had a How You Do That song. You know, it can use so many ways.
Yeah.
But what I told him, I appreciated his respect for it, reaching out to me, the folks just putting the record out and, you know, letting the world call it what they was going to call it eventually. And most definitely for the shout out and the record. The rest of those guys used that record and took the whole new audience. That saw this new generation, you know, they don't know the history of it, so nobody don't know where it started. So what the problem is, just mentioning Pete, brought you back to that evolution of where the song came from. So I appreciated that. You know, things started to take off. I didn't know the record was going to excel, and, you know, I'm not holding nothing on. I want the best to take place for him, but I didn't really come up, you know, necessarily knowing him. He didn't really know me, you know what I mean? But I appreciate it again, what he did. But what I would have, what I hoped for, you know what I mean, and wish they would have did before they remixed the song, with the remix to put it, at least include me on the record. If I hadn't heard from nobody remix, I talked to Rob Reed, I talked about that, I talked to Pete, and those were some of the things that we may have mentioned to each other. So that was my hope for the record. So at the end of the day, if I was dead with a hole in my head, you heard of me, a needle in my arm or something, then, oh, you know, do what you do. But come on, man, I'm still in the same game where y'all supposed to holler at me, man. So that's my only thing with that situation. I don't know Wiz Khalifa. I don't know Chris Brown. I don't know Tiger. You know what I mean? But that's my record. So imagine that. You know what I mean? My record that Pete put out by way of No Limit and Priority Records, man. So that's my only thing at the end of the day, man. Get something back to the place that you played it from. And I ain't necessarily talking about money. It's just respect, man. You know what I mean? If I'm in a record, I appreciate this, and I would use this as the greatest example of the situation that I'm in. When Shine remade Funky Enough, you know what I mean? Shine from Bad Boy, when he did the video, he put the DOC in the video, man. That's
right up in there. Yes, sir.
They got videos and all that. I don't get invited to no parties, no phone calls, you know what I mean? That part of it, I ain't cool with nobody in the game that's doing that any coast, man.
You know what, that's definitely real right there, man, and you know, that's why I present it to you like that and ask you like that, because that's how I feel. That's how the G-Dub listeners feel. That's how the Gangsta Nation feel. If you go and the crazy part about it is, this ain't no shit that just popped off at No Limit. We know now from talking to you, you created this shit before you even got to No Limit on your own.
Right, exactly.
So,
no problem.
So pay homage, man. You know, we had the homie Mo Preem Shakur on, man. You know what I'm saying? And he was talking about already. He was talking about how, you know, everybody taking Tupac shit. Now, I ain't no problem with it. You feel me? But pay homage to the real ones that's still here. You feel me?
Yeah. And for those who know, let's brief them on this. Mo Preem Shakur here, that's Tupac's stepbrother from Thug Life. So, you know what I mean? For out of respect for his mama, your man took that to the grave, and he meant for his family to have that. So I looked at the hologram and different things like that, and I hope they did getting their just due. I don't know all the ins and outs, but much respect to Pac. Pac was one of my favorite rappers of all time. You know, same skin and nigga fighting the same struggle. So at the end of the day, yeah, you know, I don't appreciate that for Pac. You know, the whole lot of rappers, I can go down the list of it, man, that guys, you know, it's the funny thing. You know, back in the days, if you took somebody's shit, you could tell if Rakim was cool with Daddy Kane. You could sample his record on his record. You know, rather they had a relationship or not. You could say, well, you must listen to my record because you got a part of my record in there. So, hey, you know, dig up to Daddy Kane, dig up to Rakim. But nowadays, you know, they used to say, yeah, a new nigga next year. But now it ain't even but 2 months, man. You know what I mean? They take back and run with it. So, you know, that I feel like that's a lot of problem between young and old with this game, man. If you go back to the evolution, we people, we got that. MC went to the grave the same way, fighting the same struggles, all the involved. You know, hey, man, you know, we from this place, they from that place. But, hey, man, you know, the version on the in-between, that ain't what hip-hop supposed to be about. That was supposed to unify the people. It was another outlet, you know what I mean, beyond what we have for selling dope and killing in the street. So when you do that, you get to a rich point, you know, you got all these guys going back and forth with each other. Now, that's what they want. When we complain about white man, this, that, and the other, the clubs and everything, well, it's us shooting each other at the clubs. It's us beefing on brothers, man. So if they shut it all the way down and we don't have another outlet to eat, to get back to the street. You know what I'm saying? So I thought that's what we're fighting to get away from. I saw a Jay-Z call recently. The niggas talked so much about being in the hood, but I thought it was about getting in the hood, coming back and help other people get out the hood. So anytime it's outside those boundaries, man, and they're missing the true elements of what they're supposed to be about, you know?
Already. Talk to them, please. Listen up, G-Dub listeners, breathe in the building, man. That's definitely, you know, that's real, man. And just how you speak like that, you know what I'm saying? I definitely would think that, you know, you definitely got more intellect than they probably would lead on or to know.
Yeah, man. You know, I live off of this, man. You got to know where you come from and know where you at to know where you going, man. So without the beginning and the end, you know what I mean? There ain't no in between, man. You know what I mean? So that's my whole hope. You know, all this is the constant struggle. You got to go back to rappers like Curtis Blow, you know what I mean? KRS One, Grandmaster Flair, to feel your stab. That, you know, those guys that started from Japan. That found hip hop or two turntables in Jamaica before he got to America, took it to New York, you know what I mean? Africa Bambaataa and all those cats was hard as anybody else. They were gangbangers on the East Coast, as well as on the West Coast. But for what it involved, too, when you're talking the East Coast, West Coast war, to see that, you know what I mean? It's cool to battle rap. I come up like that, even, you know, with us being from the South. That was a way of kind of lyrically training each other, you know what I mean? Or sparring more than that, you know what I mean? Where it was fun, where it was nice. You know, everybody's so at each other's throat, man. You got to watch what you're saying. You know, the places you go, and a lot of people get killed, man, based on that, man. So that part of the game I ain't never been with, man. You know what I mean? Each one teach one. So, you know, at the end of the day, I feel like that's what it is. But if we don't correct it and hold it down like Pimp say, then that shit going to wipe away, man. It's back to the jungle, no more or less, you know?
Oh, really? Damn. Official tissue, man. G-Dub listeners, y'all getting a good one from Young Bleed tonight, man. Already. Yeah, sly. So, man, like, you know, that's definitely a official tissue, man, and crazy in his own right of how this song just went and went viral. And that's the crazy part about it. That's something that you going to be known for full eternity. You feel me? When you say Young Bleed, you're going to think of how you do that there. So you just named a couple, man, that I never even knew did it. How many people exactly redid this song? Who all redid it, if you know?
Well, I'm going to say for us redoing it, you know what I mean? Like I say, you know, top of the game, you know, all of us kind of look at, you know, Jay-Z, one of the few that held down the game past 10 years, gold and platinum records. And he was actually a priority, I believe, in 96 the year before I was there. But we in the same path. You know, nothing against nobody, you know, how you do that song come out a few years ago, you know, you got a whole song called that. Some people know about that, some don't. I could pinpoint it in a whole lot of different songs, you know what I mean? When I come out, you know, and in particular you and H-Town, Scarface, a good friend of mine, old rapper, Evolution, shout out to Mean Green, you know, Lil J and everybody over there in that rapper life section.
Yes, Devin,
you know what I mean, so on and so forth. But, you know, Face was on the whole Scarface theme of the movie, the balls of my word, this, that, and the other. And the world know me as Young Bleed Cardion, so I took the Godfather syndrome and incorporated that, called myself Black Vito and different things like that. Just put the black hand side on the Italian mob side of the game, you know what I mean, as far as that gangster rap evolution trickling from N.W.A. on down to the South. You know, I always say the ghetto boys with the N.W.A. to the South. So I come up listening to all those OGs. So in no form or matter of disrespecting where I come up from the 80s game, 90s game, where if you was saying somebody else shit, you was really fighting, you know what I mean? Yeah. You started in your shit listening to the same cipher that you evolved out of, you really stealing, so you had that wasn't being original. So my whole thing was to be original, different than everybody else, but yet the same hip-hop elements that everybody else possessed, I possessed. But, of course, when Pete got wind of the rubber, you know, P's to come and say, man, that's a hard-ass title. I used to have a single on the street called My Balls and My Word. I remember the Ghetto Boys had a record that was called My Balls and My Word, but before Face did My Balls and My Word album, it was just a mellow with it, just a sample of Scarface from the movie, just saying all I have in this world of My Balls and My Word. So, you know, I had a whole different kind of track, Me Happy That Made. Happy used to make beats on the Casio keyboard. I used to always call him like a Mexican Jimi Hendrix. He's a multi-talented from the keyboard to drums to the guitar, so on and so forth. So I evolved with those guys just to separate myself, not follow nobody, you know what I mean? Not bite off nobody else's shit. So I really was on shit like Offer, You Can't Refuse, The Godfather Turn, and different things like that. As far as the whole Cardioni syndrome. But once the record got out and it got whammed that I might title my record Balls in My Word, it was already being promoted. So, you know, I followed it up, and the rest was history. It was a good thing, so I never argued with. But that, you know, that's the whole basis of that, man, you know, pretty much.
Already. Official tissue, man. So let's get these niggas up to speed, man, because, you know, you go to No Limit, you feel me? Drop one album with them. Go ahead, do my own, your own thing under the Priority umbrella. Nice little hiatus, man. I would say, you feel me? Nothing really, you know, too much after. Maybe a little this, a little that. But you emerge back on the scene with West Coast Mafia, with C-BO.
Right.
How that pop off? I mean, I know real niggas linking up is a norm, but how did that happen for you personally?
Actually, I was in Baton Rouge, and I moved out to Texas some years after that. I actually put out a couple of records through Selecto. Hits. One was called my third solo record, which was supposed to be on Priority, which was called Vintage. But, you know, Priority had a situation that took place over there that shut down the whole company, froze all the assets, and I was actually in the studio recording that record in Louisiana. And I got through the fax machine, I got a piece of paper that said pretty much a Priority has just been forced to merge and, you know, shut down and merge with Capitol Records. So for all the artists that was on Priority, that kind of separated us, broke us from under the umbrella, but forced me back into an independent, where I started a label called Detention Home Entertainment, and we put out the record. Vintage was my third solo record. Instead of putting it out through Priority, went through Selecto Hits. And after that, I put out a record and introduced the Carleone family, you know, after that, like 2004-5 or something like that. So in the midst of that, the in-between is giving y'all a gap song. You know, me and Mr. Magic ran together for a good while, and we end up coming up with that. Pretty much, you know, that I Smoke, I Drank was his song that, you know, we always talked about getting together, doing a record together. And one night, he come get me and said, I got a record. So he gave me the pillars to jump that record out. The rest was history. It started to take off like we did with the original How You Do That. Through all the country street, Louisiana, Mississippi, Texas, everybody kind of warming that record. So he started running with it. And we separated for a second. And he ended up at Body Here with Roy Jones. And, of course, you know, doing the remake with the Young Bloods and Roy Jones and all that kind of thing. I go back and forth at the pillars of Roy at the time. And we started to work together. So whatever may have taken place at Body Heated. In the midst of that, I was in Baton Rouge working with a producer cousin of mine by the name I have a label by the name of Divided Soul. His name is Brent Dixon. So Brent come to me and bring me a magazine. I want to say it was either Rap, Murder Dog. I think it was Murder Dog. It's not 2XL, but I think it was more Murder Dog. They had a picture of Yuck Moth and C-BO in a magazine, standing back to back, and I read what he was talking about. And he was asking him what a few artists that he wanted to work with throughout the rap song, of course. And yeah, my name was one of the names that he mentioned. So when I saw that, you know, I come up listening to C-BO, like listening to Ice Cube on the West Coast. So I told people to make an effort to reach C-BO people. And at the time, you know, Bo was doing a little penitentiary time, so he called me one day from the pen, let me know everything was real, go ahead and make the West Coast Mafia deal. And I went out to California for me to come home, got with T-Bo, two guys that represent the West Coast Mafia. And everything was official. So what Bo saw was the same thing, you know, how I evolved from the South into the West. A lot of people don't know this. Rest in peace to DJ Scoop. Scoop was really from California. Grew up, come home to the South, I believe, real young, if I'm not mistaken. Shout out to Issues.
You're right.
So, DJ Scoop was, I think, well, I want to say, was the first guy to introduce C-BO to the South. So, naturally, C-BO had a South backing as well as he had a West Coast backing. So, he recognized that being a part of AWOL record when they started with the Gas Chain, and, of course, into the West Coast Mafia. That he hid, of course, so naturally he saw where, hey man, let's swap his own, but if you got a nice John, I got a nice John, that I'm one of the few cats that recognize you, and of course I recognize him, so he come down, I lived in Dallas for about 7 years, so he come out for a few years, me and Bo did a lot of work between the West and the South, me and West and a few other places, so, you know, particularly interest, you know, to this day, they call me and Bo, big brother, little brother, man, just talked to Bo a few days ago, so. There's a lot of rappers out to say this, that, and the other, but I vouch for the ones that stay near and dear to my heart and really, you know, some brother shit with me, real life shit, and we all support each other from an independent standpoint without the mate. So he wanted to chose a few. Shout out to Big Mike, man. Big Mike working on a record right now. So those type of OGs I always come up, you know, listening to and looking up to. And like a dream come through, they come to me one day in so many different ways. You know what I mean? I got an infinite list on Coast Atlanta, but now it's on the other hand. So pretty much like that. We sorry for my market and love, man. The web ain't nothing popping up top. We got each other. You push this way. Reintroduce me to the South. You reintroduce me to the West. I go from that still to the day that remains.
Already. And that's love, man, that y'all still, you know, making it happen. You know what I'm saying? It's still, you know, clicking up together to this day, because at the end of the day, you dropped two, I still want to say, you know, hard-ass underground albums, you feel me, with Bolo, the West Coast Mafia, you feel me, and, you know, both of them were solid. They both got hits on rotation in GDUPRADIO, Official Tissue. But after that, you know, the Young Bleed train don't stop, you feel me? Because then, already, you end up popping off on strange music, you feel me, with Tech N9ne. Now, I got to say this real quick, Blee. When I first seen that, I said, what the fuck? Like, what is he doing on streaming? But then I thought about it, and I said, man, you know, Bleed is unique in his own way, just like them nigga here. So it fits so perfectly after why, you know what I'm saying? So let them know, man, what was the transition, you know, what happened for you not to be on West Coast Mafia no more, and how did you hook up with Tech N9ne?
Of course, like I said, man, Bo was pushing from an independent label, you know, distribution deals here and there, by far. So, you know, Bo real live street nigga, you know what I mean? He'll go in and out of jail at different times, you know, different times like that. So in the midst of that, you know, I deal with my West Coast Mafia affiliated. I'm good with everybody under the umbrella, so we always could do what we wanted to do. But without that hit with Bo, that kind of stopped for a minute and had to wait for him to do his time. In the midst of that time, we always really trying to get on Strange, in particular me, C-BO, Freesco, Doug Riz, my man from The Original No Limit, and Big Mike. Me and Big Mike was actually working on the record that we're working on now. We formulated a group called Cajun Mafia that initially supposed to be me, him, and Fiend. Fiend did like one song or something with us. And he had some complication of what I believe he backed out the record or something. So me and Mike kept pushing. But going back to the priority days, Dave Weiner, you know, for a lot of people that's not familiar with Dave Weiner, he hosted on some of those beef episodes that used to come out. Was a dear friend of mine in the A&R. By the time I got to Priority, the first guy walked me off a plane and introduced me to California. I spent a month in Priority Records. So me and Dave had a 15-year relationship, or, you know, 16 or so at this point in time. But I was working with some guys in the Kansas City area. Shout out to Chauncey Platt and a whole lot of guys, you know what I mean, just in the KC-Mo area. We was working on a record called Three-Headed Monster, and I didn't know, I wasn't really up on Strange, I was up on Tech N9ne and so on and so forth, at least from a gang-related record that Tech first appeared out, you know, as far as I know to the world, my favorite song from Tech N9ne, it's called Questions on that gang-related record that Tupac, you know, the movie he did with Jim Belushi before he passed. I was familiar with Tech, but I would have never guessed. I always, you know, if anybody, if I like your music, you know, matter of me, big or small, I want to work with you or whatever the case might be. But that was always an interest of mine, but not knowing how and whatever, you know what I mean? I ain't necessarily know the basis of Tech to reach out to him. So just like anything else, the show, the party, we all run across each other. So Dave was with my guy Chauncey in Kansas City, and he gave me he was letting him check out the Three-Headed Monster record that we did. It was like, you know, Bleed, yeah, I know Bleed, we'll, you know, so on and so forth. How can I reach him, give Dave my number, when I talk to Chauncey, and he put me and Dave Weiner back together. Dave let me know at the time, I think he had took a break from the industry for all the records after everything had took place over there, and was coming back into it, and was really action, and still to this day, I believe, the vice president at Strange Music. So, from that, you know, he walked me into a deal, I didn't know Tech N9ne in particular, you know what I mean, but that's what introduced me to Tech, and everything was beautiful, Brother Lynch. I know Brother Lynch was on Priority at 97 when he did a loaded record, so we was familiar with each other, so on and so forth. So there was some reuniting on that end where Lynch was concerned. But since, you know, I mean, it was our first time working together. So everything was beautiful, man. I stayed around there maybe a year or so, some change like that, did a tour with those guys. And pretty much, you know what I mean, you know, left the label after that, you know, based on a few circumstances, different things was taking place. So, but other than that, here again, there ain't no bad blood. It's all business at the end of the day. So I did what I had to do over there. And been working on my next project that I got finna come out in a minute since then. But basically, there on the strength of Dave Winer, that's what got me to start music, man.
Already, Official Tissue, man. So, you know, that's crazy that you say that, you know, you moved on from Strange Music because
yeah.
I've been waiting for an album you had to come out with them for, shit, I don't want to say about 2 years now. So, you know, I think it's called All of Medicine or something like that. So, is anything still coming out from Strange Music? You still got one album with them, or you just not with them right now?
Okay, the truth about it, we was talking about J-Rock and them earlier. Me and J-Rock was tripping on this when we first met.
Yeah.
His initial was TDE. I said, damn, man, I got a label. I already did a co-op deal with Strange. I hadn't signed to a major since Priority. Everything was either a co-op deal with Detention Home. I ended up shutting down Detention Home and started a new label called Trap Doe Entertainment. So the same TDE, you know, we was tripping out that we had in common. So, yeah, right now, I'm actually in the yoke right now working on it. I started promoting, you know, slightly that Automatic album, like right after the Strange record. But what I ended up doing, since the time gathering so many more producers coming from so much of the sound, I got so much music that I'm really just finding out is right now to get ready to put it out. Got it backed up before that album, working on a mixtape that's called No Guidelines. It's going to come out real soon. I'm doing it. EP, like an introduction to the album right after that, called The Legend of Bleeding Rallo, and then I'm going to drop that All American. So what I'm going to do, in particular, I got some singles that I'm looking at dropping one or two before the year is out. I'm really going to get back at the top of the year, through the one. I have but a few more months left to set that in motion. So my whole aim is to get that mixtape out for the year is out and a couple of singles off the EP, and I'm going to roll into the new year with that new record, man. So that's what it do.
Already, Official Tissue, G'd up listeners, listen to this real shit from Young Bleed on deck. Yeah, man. Hey, that's Official Tissue, man. So, you know, it's crazy that, you know, this roller coaster ride that you gone on, you know what I'm saying, to get everything that you want. But at the same time, you still putting out music, you still putting out hits, and from the way it's signed, you still accept it and respect it by all the real ones all day long.
Yes, sir, all the way around. Look, let it go. I put it together for a turn. When the fire dies down with the, I know you cussed on the radio, but you know the blank. But what you gonna do? You know, damn, it feels good to be a gangster, but so nothing feel better than that at the end of the day. You walk away with your life. Man, you know, nothing feel better than that. You know, money ain't everything. Money come and go, and you can't take it when you're dead and gone, man. So I appreciate that from everybody everywhere, bro. Yes, sir.
Already, that's definitely Official Tissue, man. So, you know, we 2013, man, and Young Bleed definitely on deck. Man, let everybody know what's about to come out, what they need to be looking forward to. You know what I'm saying? As far as Young Bleed moving forward in this future.
Okay, yeah, Trap Doe Entertainment. Actually, I got some distribution in L.A., man, that I'm working with right now, putting this together for as far as the label. I'm relaunching my label, Trap Doe Entertainment. I'm going to drop it off with the introduction, like I say, with a mixtape. I never did a mixtape in life. I might appear on a few, but I had never did a Y'all Bleed mixtape. So it's going to be the first time I do this mixtape that I'm calling No Guidelines. And like I say, I'm going to follow it up with an EP called The Legend of Bleeding Rallo. And for going into 2014, I'll get ready for All American, but that's what it do.
Already, Official Tissue GW listeners. Make sure y'all get that real shit, man. Hey, so check this out, Blee. We got this shit straight from the big homie Snoopy, man. And, you know, we basically going to start a sentence and you finish it.
Okay, beautiful. Let's go.
Already. I hate when people.
You said you hate when people.
I hate when people.
I say that one more time. I can't make up what you're saying all the way.
All right, I hate when people.
I hate new people.
I hate when people, like, I hate when people when, talk shit, or I hate when people.
Okay, well, yeah, I say that. You gotta help me out. I hate when people bullshit, man, with it like that.
Already. Right. If I could work with anybody, I would want to work with.
Infinite List, Rakim, Ice Cube, you know what I mean? Cam, MC8 I'm working with, Mac Maul, you know, I can go on and on with that one. E40, you know, all those guys, in cahoots we're working with now, Slick Rick, you know, Jaleel from Houdini, you know what I mean? So old school to new school, man, I'm with that.
Already, Official Tissue. If I could smoke with anybody or kick it with anybody, I would want to smoke with.
I'm trying to go outside the box. A lot of cats and ride with me and smoke with me. Let me think. Let me pull that ball off for you, man. Some of the best smokers. I've smoked with Snoop. Shout out to Snoop. You know what I mean? Daz, of course. Devin, the dude. I think who I haven't smoked with. You know what I mean? Let me see. Like I say, y'all, some of those same robbers, man, what I try to do, you know, I had the honor of working on meeting Rick James. Curtis Mayfield cleared a sample for me, and Roger Troutman was going to redo do what I did it with me before he passed. So I go back for his music, and any legend that I catch, any genre of music, I try to go back and work with those cats. I mean?
Oh, really? Damn, Official Tish, you just hit him with one right there, Bleed. If I could see anybody... Go ahead.
Let me add this to the collection player. Actually, I'll probably be in Toledo, Ohio tomorrow night with George Clinton, man. I always want to come up off that P-Funk here with my pops and uncles and all that had those records. So I got the offer to come open up a show for George Clinton tomorrow night, Toledo, Ohio, man. So, yeah, that's one of my favorite lifetime players of players, you know what I mean?
Okay, already. Listen to that game, G-Dub listeners. The homie Bleed will be in the dro tomorrow, man. Might be in the dro. Open it up for George Clinton, man. Damn, that's real.
Yeah. Hey, look, that's what I want to smoke with. The Funk Father, yeah. I would need to put something in there with George. Him and Boosie Collins. Now, that's what I'm trying to do, bro.
And you do know that. Damn. Shit, I wish I could be there for that one. All right. If I could see anybody perform live, I would want to see.
Let's see, man. Who was that? Ice Cube, I have to say. KRS-One, you know, say he's one of the greatest hip hop performers of all time. I had the privilege of being with Dougie Fresh on stage and Slick Rick with him at one time. But like I say, it's infinite, man. It's hard for me, you know, rapping category right now. I mean, now you got Christian rap, the gangster rap, hip hop. So, yeah, it's an infinite list, man. It's a lot of people that I had a chance growing up, I was able to see. I'm still a fan to the music like I always was. So, yeah, that goes with all genres of music, man. Yeah, so it's a lot of people where that's concerned. But in particular, it'd be hard for me to reach, you know, and a power. A lot of people don't know I've been doing this since 83. So this 30 years that I've been, you know, straight rap music from 9 years old up to now, man. So, yeah, that goes a lot of way.
Already. What's up? Round of applause. Did you just say 30?
30 years, man. 9 years old. Just turned with 39 this year, man. So that's 30 exact years for me. Has been on that pen and pad, bro.
Go ahead, Bleed. Go ahead, man. Man, so many of them took the dance with the devil and death. Man, go ahead, man. Cheat up listeners. Listen to this real shit, man.
Yes, sir. Right on.
Already, Official Tissue, man. Damn, I mean, we could definitely go all night, man. Like, I had a whole list of shit still to ask you, man. But, you know, we almost dead with it, man. So, you know, if you can real quick, homie, a nice radio drop, man. And a shout out to all the G-Dub radio listeners tuned in to you right now.
Okay, man, yeah, of course, man, it's your boy, Devin Bleed, Carter Young, representing that 33rd Coast, Southside, Bottom Boy, BR, man. Shout out right now to, you know what I mean, most in particular to everybody over there at UGK Records, man. He's a Leo, C-Rip, you know what I mean, so on and so forth. Y'all keep y'all head up. Rest in peace to the pimp, what up the barn, rest in peace to Mama Whit. All the way around the board, the Carter Young family, Carter Young gang, Carter Young mafia, whole clique, man. So, you know, that's what that is, man. Already.
Definitely Official Tissue, man. So, before we get up out of here, Bleed, man, let everybody know, you know what I'm saying, one quick time, how they can find you, how they can, you know, how the fans can keep in touch with you, and everything you want to plug right now. Go ahead and let them know, Blee.
Okay, well, yeah, man, of course, there's a one to add this too, man. Of course, shout out to everybody over there at GDUPRADIO, man. I appreciate y'all, man. It's an honor and a privilege, man. Much love. But at the same token, you know, I always say this, man, Facebook for the ghetto, so Twitter for the suburbs, man. So anybody trying to reach me on the Facebook, just go to just Young Bleed. You know, there's a lot of fake Young Bleeds on there. I detected a few boys, but go to the Young Bleed with the official gold record. Background cover, my balls and my word, you know what I mean? That's my backdrop. And for everybody that's on Twitter, just go to that real Young Bleed. You find me, y'all. Thanks, folks.
Already. Definitely official tissue, man. Hey, let me ask you a personal question, man. You ever did like any voiceovers, anything like that, man? Because I mean, the voice is significant. Whenever Bleed rap, you know it's Bleed. A lot of motherfuckers ain't like that. So you ever did any voiceovers, man? Anything like that to cater to your voice?
Not to this day, man. It's a lot of things I'm working on, you know. Nothing officially out to the world just yet, you know.
Already, you got to get that popping, Bleed. They need that voice out there, man.
Right on. Good looking, bro. Appreciate that. Yeah, I'm trying to get into the cartoon, comic books, wherever it go, man. Like Short say, I'm trying to get in where I fit in. Y'all, you know, like me.
Already, yeah. Man. Shit, it's been a million, man. Like I said, man, thanks a million for coming on and touching down with us real ones, man. It mean more than you know, Bleed.
You say what that again?
I said it mean more than you know, man. You coming on and touching down with us, man. It mean a lot.
Oh, yeah, same here, bro. I appreciate that, bro. It's all about the network, bro. I support who support me. So, y'all here again. Much love. Shout out to GDUPRADIO, bro. You stay in contact with me. Let's keep this going on. That's all I ask, bro. That's good luck. Uh-huh.
Already. Official tissue, man. Thanks, homie.
Okay, take it easy, bro.
Already.
Yes, sir.
And you do know that. That's official tissue, man. It don't get no realer than that, man. I mean, you understand me. You know, it mean a lot when you talk about legends and you talk about them in a sense of the nigga still here. You underdigs that. Like, we not talking about motherfuckers that's dead and gone and all that shit. The homie did, and you do, how you do that there, what, 98? You feel me? And it's still getting remixed in 2001, Trey? Get the fuck out of here, man. Real niggas do real things, man. Shouts out to the whole Baton Rouge. Definitely shout out to the homie Young Bleed, man. Official tissue, real nigga doing it, man. And mobbing and moving and grooving and showing love to us real ones, man. It don't get no better than that, man. Official tissue, man. Recognize real one when you see one. Young Bleed, Baton Rouge on deck.
Real life, it ain't to be played with. Whoa. I learned to double it up for some dollars. Hooked up with a dope fiend, turned my soul shit into hard pods. I'm on the block slanging amphetamines. I'm thinking about my ghetto dreams on a triple B. Ain't no turning back, I'm way too deep. I got prices over my head by niggas in the hood and the police. A young nigga trying to make it. 20 inch rims, candy wood, that's why they hate me. So, bring the noise, nigga. So, pass me the toys, nigga.
Ain't ready now, you won't ever be ready. They trying to catch me for steady stacking confetti is heavy. But let me explain the game to break the chains of pain and misery. Claim my fame throughout this game and remain a mystery. Is you peeping my skin? Is you seeing it's real? Is you hurting from hating, making me reach for my steel? Knowing I'm running for ballers and steady clicking the killer's graveyard filler. I announced a mighty drug dealer. And bitches love niggas paying dues without nothing to lose. Acting a fool, the savage style from New Orleans to Baton Rouge. On the cool out, making it pop, it don't stop. Till I stack a million chips, that's off the top. Is you feeling me? I'm willing, it ain't no killing. I bet your life will never be the same for blood spilling. Damn, it's the Murgatroyd, they got me falling like the big boy. I'm shaking up some shit, I thought you knew I bring the noise, bitch.
Bring the noise, nigga.
Understand that, man. Shouts out to the homie Young Bleed, man. Coming through, really putting it down for all y'all G'd up listeners, man. Gangsta niggas doing gangsta shit. Real niggas on deck.
Young Bleed and Young Keys like a wild stampede. With shit that eat it, you see. They gobble up like bird feed. Me by me, a killer by killer. Hustle for scratch. Snatch a batch by a nappy weave and pimp it like that. Hood rats out the trap, become the hostile hoes. Pop your collar on that one to let them know. This is how I'm supposed to go. CDs and posters, so we making money over bitches. Before the show, I'm in my zone. Cardio, manage my mafioso. I'm so-so, death in the flesh. But peep the logo, I'm loco. Crazy as fuck, get off my nuts. Play your hackin' police, looking for me. I'm in the cut, nigga, what's off side, and I can give a fuck. Hit the pussy on the first day, and I ain't give a fuck. Nigga, get down, before I clown, with about 17 rounds. With a click that keep me up, never letting me down. Pound, fuck the hound on it. We keep them clarions clacking with the hound.